The Master's
Welcome to the Master's Playground. I am your host, Chrissy Stereo, and tonight our topic is Kabbalah Tarot. I have a couple of guests on with us. I'm so incredibly excited to welcome you to the Master's Playground. You are our official first guest. Michael and Krista of the Mystic Raven will be performing readings for us tonight. Welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yay.
Yay.
We're excited.
Excellent. Excellent. So, in getting started, before it is customary, before any show begins, I do take a moment to tune in. So excuse me for a moment. I'm going to, you know, connect with my higher self and, you know, go from there. So audience, for those of you that are following along, you pretty much know that I tune in by chanting the Adi Mantra three times. Before I do so, I want to clear a little energy. All right. Here we go. Placing our hands into it. A prayer position in front of our heart chakras. Eyes closed, spine straight. We're going to chant Ong Namo Gurudev Namo three times. Inhale in and out. And on the next breath, we'll begin. Ong brings me back into a grounded, I could deal, you know, with the radio show space. All right. Well, I want to go ahead and just dive into how you started Kabbalah Tarot. What was it? Well, let's go back in time a little bit. So tell us a little bit about where you met, where you grew up, and how Tarot came into your life.
Do you want to start?
Well, we met in Nova Scotia. I was living there and Krista was going to school there. And for me personally, in my mid-30s, I began to search for something spiritual and a friend turned me on to tarot. She thought with the way my brain worked that it might be something I would enjoy and I gravitated towards it. In terms of the Kabbalistic part of it, the tarot actually is Kabbalah. And if you're really going to read it properly and understand it properly, you do have to understand a little bit about that philosophy. Otherwise, the images are very misleading and very easily misinterpreted. And unfortunately, I think a lot of the books don't really stress it enough and just mislead people into really negative ways of looking at some of the cards when they're all very neutral, really. They're just different forces. So we kind of stumbled upon it. And Krista and I met Krista at a bookstore in Halifax. And we started talking about the tarot and studying it together. And over about a three-year period, we kind of pieced it all together. And the biggest influence was probably the book by Aleister Crowley, who is the infamous occultist from the Victorian age,
right?
Late Victorian. And he really was the one that kind of fleshed out the whole Kabbalistic thing. Now, his book, for people who have never read it, I tell them, the good news, it's by Crowley. The bad news, it's by Crowley. And you know, he talks a lot in riddles and metaphor, and it's very twisted in places. And right. To be honest, I like to think that I have a bit of a brain. It took me about 2 years to figure out what the heck he was talking about.
Right.
But once you get it, it's brilliant. And then it kind of ruins you for everything else on the tarot.
Wow.
But it took us about 3 years to kind of piece it all together. And then we were actually doing a reading for a party in Beverly Hills one night. Some older couple was having an anniversary party. And the last person I read for that night was a Kabbalistic rabbi. Mm-hmm. And we were using Crowley's deck. It has the Hebrew letters on the major cards. And he noticed them. And he said, those are the Hebrew letters. I said, well, yeah, it's Kabbalah. I said, there are 22 major cards. They connect with the 22 pathways on the Tree of Life. He said, well, lay out the Tree of Life for me. And I did. He said, now explain it to me. And I thought, this should be pretty good. I'm going to explain Kabbalah to a rabbi. And I've never read a book on the subject. To read the tarot. And so I explained it to him. And he listened intently. And then he kind of laughed. He said, well, let's just say you have your own way of putting things. He said, we would use different terminology. I said, all your principles are fundamentally really, really sound. He said, that is what it is. It's just you're describing it in your own language. So it really, really verified that we'd kind of come to the right conclusion after about 3 years. But Krista and I worked on it, literally about 16 hours a day. We'd wake up talking about a card or a pathway and go to sleep talking about it, wake up the next morning still talking about it.
Now, did you guys end up figuring out, for example, let's say you take the Seven of Wands or something. Mm-hmm. Did you instinctively know where to place it? Was there some type of foundation that you were working with? Or
there's a diagram that is mainly, I think it's the Golden Dawn tradition. There are different layouts of the cards, but we used the Tree of Life diagram that really was put together initially by Elphas Levi, but then the Golden Dawn in the 1800s, early 1900s, they did a lot of theory and ritual, and they created this Tree of Life where they put the astrology, the numerology, and a lot of people, the metaphysics, like that particular diagram. And I think that I like it because it works, but also they did test things out a lot. They did a lot of ritual, a lot of magic,
right?
And it works. So there are a couple of different correlations, but we use the one that's, Crowley uses, and I think it's basically the same as the Golden Dawn. And so we memorized that tree where the cards are laid out a certain way. The Seven of Wands are in the number seventh sphere, and that didn't take too long. But then we literally thought about, why are they in that position? Why does the Empress connect to the twos and threes? What is the meaning of that? And what was brilliant was it's the first time we'd ever had an opportunity to synthesize the cards. There's no book out there yet that can teach you how to put it together.
Yet. I'm still trying to get that book out of you guys.
I think I was the one initially kind of interested in the Kabbalah because we were living temporarily with my father on Fairfax, and there was Roseanne Barr was doing a Kabbalistic lecture at the center there. And we went there and she did a great lecture, actually. But we realized it wasn't what we were looking for in terms of the Kabbalah. And we just decided, OK, we'll do it ourselves, because we actually did look for a teacher out here.
Right.
And at the time, which was 1997, 98, there wasn't anyone at least visible that would teach the way we wanted to learn it.
Right.
And then we also had some kind of cool friends, too, that knew metaphysics. Some were a little crazy. But we would ask them their opinions on different things metaphysically.
A little crazy.
And one really was, but he's a brilliant guy, handwriting analysis, and he's brilliant guy, but a little crazy. But he would talk to us a lot about his thoughts. And Michael's right. We literally pounded it out for several years, and to the point where I even dreamed I was the Hanged Man, and I woke up in the position of the Hanged Man.
Wow. You were becoming the cards.
I was.
You were becoming the cards. Wow.
Yeah, the interesting thing really about the tarot and what I've discovered looking at all these different ways of using different tools, whether it's astrology or numerology, I really think, and Crowley felt as well, that the two most profound were the tarot and the I Ching, and they really are, I think, the most profound systems out there.
Right.
Not only because you can use them to do a reading or get some information, but they actually teach a whole life philosophy, and the tarot itself contains the entire philosophy of Kabbalah, which is, again, that Hebrew mystical philosophy going back thousands of years. And when you're studying I Ching, you're actually studying Taoism, so you become very conversant in all the Taoist way of looking at life and as practiced by Confucius and so forth. So that they just give you this incredible depth that I don't think there's any other system out there that really touches on that same level of depth that those two particular systems have. And then that they're just really great for just fortune-telling, for lack of a better word, as well. They work.
What's really interesting, I was reading about, visiting your site, mysticraven.net, and reading about each of you, and each of you actually started your exposure to mysticism separately before you actually met.
Yes.
And from what I understand, you were actually reading Tarot in that area that where you grew up. And with you, Krista, you took more of a shamanic totem. I believe there was a a teacher by the name of Old Crow.
Yes, my friend Lainey, and that is her name. And she had
that name. Old Crow.
She's just such a wonderful person. She had the medicine card deck out in her house. I used to hang out there a lot. And she and her husband studied with traditional Lakota for many, many years. And she was very open about her love of nature. She would always talk to animals in front of people and say that she loved them and they were beautiful. Sure. And I loved that about her. And she has a really wonderful, loving heart. And so I used to pick a card from the deck, the animal cards, the medicine cards. And I kind of fell in love with that deck first. In fact, when we first started reading, Michael and I read in a mall in Nova Scotia, and we would have, for one reading, Michael would do the tarot, and I didn't know the tarot at the time, even though I knew a lot of other metaphysical things. I would do a medicine card reading as part of the whole reading. So they actually had a couple reading with two different cards, and we did that. And then Michael decided that the tarot was more popular, which was true. Mm-hmm. So I got a crash course in about a month of the tarot.
How was that? Did you adapt well?
I don't recommend it. I mean, it was very nerve-wracking. I did have a lot of metaphysical background, and I have an intuitive nature.
Of course.
And being a poet, I think I can see in symbols. But it was pretty nerve-wracking to do it professionally, even for a minimal fee just a month. But, you know, universe gives you something, you got to go for it, right?
Exactly.
And I had Michael there. So, but I really had to prove myself a little more than Michael did in Nova Scotia for some reason. And I think I did. But it would have been hard without Michael there, just in terms of confidence.
Right. You know? I think that may, and correct me if I'm wrong, the history, it's very rich. There's a Celtic history.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that embraces, you know, quite a bit of mysticism in the area.
And yeah, I think we grew up with it, you know. And I mean, Nova Scotia Latin translates into New Scotland and a lot of the Celtic. There's a lot of little villages there where people still speak Gaelic. Mm-hmm. And the old people say their bedtime prayers still in Gaelic every night. And of course, you know, the old Celtic people, that they were just very connected to a lot of mysticism. It's interesting. I met a guy once who said that he felt that the people from Scotland in particular were probably the most gifted psychic people on the face of the earth almost, in terms of European culture anyway.
Wow.
And he said the reason for that, in his opinion, was that the Inquisition didn't really reach far into the highlands of Scotland because it was so wild and inaccessible and so forth. So. In a lot of Europe and Germany and France and so forth, back in the Middle Ages, if you had an ability as a reader, or you were interested in occult things or metaphysical things or just using your intuition, you would tend to suppress that because it was very dangerous. If somebody caught you doing readings, you'd get burnt at the stake. So, the natural tendency for generations was to suppress it, whereas in Scotland, it just flourished because there wasn't really that level of suppression there.
Right,
I thought it was an interesting theory. I don't know if he was right or not, but it was... But I know people home, and it's funny because I still, when people say, oh, you do tarot, and they get all excited that I'm a reader, and to me, it's not that big a deal. And people home just kind of do it naturally. It's not a big deal, you know?
Yeah.
Because it's just a way of being.
Well, there is a fascination with the unknown, you know? I know for our listeners, I do want to take a moment to remind everybody that we are taking in callers this evening. If you are interested in receiving a very brief one question tarot reading, you're more than welcome to give us a call at 1-800-893-9562. And so what I wanted to do is actually start to play a little bit, you know, of music, and, you know, just to give it people a flavor of the type of music that was fairly popular or still is in that region that you grew up in. If you wouldn't mind actually introducing the song, I believe I mentioned it, you know, it's called The Tower. If you wouldn't mind giving us a little insight on the song.
Well, Christa Berg that wrote and performed it was probably best known for doing Lady in Red back in the day, but he was a real bard, and he actually grew up his family owned a castle in Ireland, so he actually grew up in this ancient castle in Ireland, so he got very wrapped up in all the folklore and mythology and paganism and so forth. So he wrote a number of songs that sort of touched on those themes, and certainly very much a bard in the old traditional sense that we have home of the bards that are great musical storytellers.
Right.
I think this one tells a pretty significant story.
So. Oh, excellent. Let's go ahead and cue her up. Okay, one second here.
Play song, please.
A great lord came walking through the forest one morning with a weapon in his hand. Rich was his castle, he lacked for nothing, but killing was his plan. When a white bird flew by, she fell from the sky. Nothing was found, only blood on the ground. She was gone. Cursing his fortune, he turned to the forest to kill once again. Standing before him was a lovely young woman with her hand hung in pain. When he saw her, his eyes were filled with desire. He said, I must have her, she must be mine. She will be mine. He offered her silver, he offered her gold, but she threw it on the ground. He fell to his knees and he begged her, oh please come with me, what you wish will be found. She said, sir, I'll go if you put up your bow and spare these creatures, leave them in peace. You have no lost in the wind. His eyes were fixed on a queen, and all he saw was a woman, and all she was a dream. Took her and bound her with ropes tied around her to his castle. He did ride. In a wood was a bower where stood an old tower, and he threw her deep inside. Then the birds left the sky, and a terrible cry brought thunder and lightning and rain falling down. Tears on the ground. All through the days on her face he would gaze, for she was lovely as the spring. No word would she speak, but leave them in peace, and some sad lament she would sing. Oh, one day by the door, at the window he saw a single feather was lying on the floor. She was there no more. Now that great lord is dying, his cold heart is crying for the love of a girl. For many an hour he has wept on the tower, for she meant more than in the sky. A white bird flew by, he lifted his hand, he cried out in pain. Come back again. But his words were lost in the wind. His castle was built upon sand. Yeah.
welcome back to the Master's Playground. I am your host, Chrissy Stereo, and we are very honored to welcome the Mystic Raven to the playground that is all things the Master's Playground. So thank you again for joining me, joining us, joining this arena to share your knowledge and insight and rich history with Tarot. I wanted to ask you guys a little bit about... Now, obviously, there's different systems out there of interpreting Tarot. There's, you know, a variety of different books, a variety of different, basically, popular methods. And I wanted to ask you a little bit about what your thoughts are in regards to the type of Tarot that you've developed and read versus what's popular out there.
Well, one of the things about the tarot is it's very versatile and dynamic, and I really think it's great that there are different systems. I think it's important with the tarot, however, to actually use it as a tool, and I feel like a lot of people don't. Mm-hmm. And I also feel like people take the images very literally, and that was never, ever intended. It's a symbol, right. And symbols are dynamic, and they also change with cultures. Mm-hmm. Even astrology has noticed that we're not the same astrologers as we were like thousands of years ago because it's different now. Our consciousness is growing, hopefully, and... So I'm afraid a lot of the tarot books are very repetitive, and they actually have some definitions that go back to the very beginning of tarot, which make no sense.
Wow.
And yeah. So my feeling is that it's not that our system is the only, it is one of the best ones out there, though, because it's based on something so rich and deep,
right,
as the Kabbalah, that you can just keep learning and learning.
Yeah.
And it's just great. I mean, I don't know that there's one that has this kind of possibility out there, but I'm certainly sure that there are people that use the cards in their own way that can give a good reading. Mm-hmm. My belief is that the reading is it's part the reader and also, like I said, using the tool itself instead of like saying, oh, you know, I'm going to memorize this card and this is what it always means. Mm-hmm. And that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Just to give you an idea how the definitions change so much. The Nine of Swords is one of those cards. I actually read one book in the tarot that said there must be something good about this card, but if there is, I can't find it. So,
wow.
And it's typically seen as doom and gloom and suffering and misery. And even Crowley, although he's using a sense of humor, calls it cruelty. And Crowley liked to play jokes. He knew it wasn't a bad card, but he liked to play into that popular mythology, I think. But if you understand it Kabbalistically, all the Nine of Swords mean, to experience or do something. So it's an activity or an event or something happening. The Nine is a very manifest number, so it's not an idea or a concept. It's something that's actually unfolding or occurring, something real. And then the idea of it being on the center pillar means it's to do the will of God or to do what's necessary, what serves the greater good or what's best. Now, the reason it's called cruelty is because you're not supposed to allow your subjective emotions to interfere in that judgment. Mm-hmm. I'm supposed to do the right thing, whether I like it or not, so to speak. And right. That's the idea of being devoid of emotion, because to do what's best or to do what's necessary is not about how you feel. It's about doing something effectively, something for a greater purpose, you know, and so forth. And it can be very blissful or it can be very difficult, but it's still doing the right thing or doing what's best. And and so that's a whole different interpretation you would get in almost any book on the tarot that you're going to pick up. And that's one of the first cards I always flip to. And no one's ever satisfied me that they understand what they're talking about when they talk about that card from a Kabbalistic point of view.
I understand what you're saying. I mean, you know, obviously I'm a student of yours, and, you know, I... have, you know, I'm still waiting for, it's like I want to move in and like, give me more. And you're like, no, really, you have a good foundation. You know? But in general, a reaction that I do notice out there is, you know, a response to the Tower card, a response to the Death card, or, you know, these preconceived, you know, doom and gloom, you know, notions. Right. That...
Well, the thing too is that the tarot is meant to be used, and we have been very fortunate to literally have done, I don't know, 16,000-17,000 readings at this point. Mm-hmm. And there are some things that just don't hold up consistently. And one of the ones I made the mistake in the beginning with swords before we did Kabbalah as seeing them as challenges. I'll never forget the reading. I remember even the outcome was, it was like the Nine and the Ten of Swords, and it was this young woman graduating. She had a perfectly normal, fine life. She was completing something successfully. And when I started talking about, oh, the many challenges, she was looking at me like I was crazy. And I would take that feedback seriously. I think, what am I doing wrong? And so that got me thinking about that sort of initial interpretation of the swords or challenges. And certainly certain ones could be based on Kabbalah, but In her case, she was finishing successfully mm-hmm. her school. She had done what's necessary in a sense. And looking back, I would say Kabbalistically, I would have said something completely differently.
Right.
And again, it's not the other thing about being a reader, if you want to do it for people, is you're going to make mistakes mm-hmm. and it's okay. And people are pretty forgiving, you know, I mean, as long as you're not like cruel and horrible to them. But
no, of course, yeah.
You have
yeah.
to be willing to kind of put yourself out there and test it. And that's what we did with the Kabbalah. We really tested it. We really, you know, tried it over and over again to see if it worked.
It's something fascinating as a reader, and I've been, you know, performing it since I've, you know, learned from you. Well, you know, there's intuition that goes into all of it, but there's something very, very magical in a moment of where you understand the cards, you understand the layout, you understand the position, you know, the spread that you're doing. And then all of a sudden there's like a gush of intuition where, mm-hmm. you know, the entire story comes together, you know? And so I'm a little fascinated to you know, what kind of experiences do you go through when you are actually performing the reading, you know, and, you know, seeing that snapshot of the whole story, you know,
You bring up a good point. And one of the things that I think a mistake many books that are teaching tarot make is to tell people to analyze one card. And it's not mm-hmm. really about one card. They're supposed to tell a story and they need a pattern to do that. So yeah. by looking at numerous cards together, you see a story, you see a big picture unfold. Mm-hmm. And that gives you the information that you really need to work with. And then the idea really, the magic in tarot is, why are those cards chosen in that specific second of time? What caused you to create that pattern? And I think there are a lot of theories about that and why that works. But for me, it's that meaningful synchronicity. And I mean, Jung was into it. A lot of people recognize it, that there's something that connects that seemingly unrelated thing of drawing this little pattern of cards with that greater thing that's going on in your life at that moment.
Right,
and somehow
right.
those things are not disconnected the way that they should logically be. And right. I think that there is a wisdom in that. But then I also think that people, and many people create unrealistic expectations when it comes to doing readings as well, you know, and in the end, we still have free will. Mm-hmm. Krista will verify, we've had people, you'll do a reading for them and they'll leave the room and do the exact opposite of everything you've talked about.
Right,
and then
right,
they wonder
right.
why it's not turning out the way that you discussed, you know? And,
yeah, yeah.
And we still have free will and you still have to do the work. You still have to show up in life and make an effort. And
right.
you could have a phenomenal energy for being successful in radio, but if you sit home and don't do a radio show, it's not going to do you any good.
Exactly.
You
know? Exactly.
You got to
yeah.
show up and do the work.
Yeah,
right? And,
exactly.
and we're big on that. And then the other thing I think we have to understand when we talk about prediction is that we're really still dealing with the realm of probability. And every decision that you make in your life, understanding probability is a big factor in your decision making. Mm-hmm. So if I'm going to pursue something and put my time and resources and energy into it, does it at least have a reasonable chance of working out well? And mm-hmm. if it does, then I'm prepared to take the risk. I'm prepared to make the effort and so forth. And
yeah.
that's really what the readings are trying to do. And then if you're skilled with it, you may see an area where you could tweak the odds a little bit. Maybe I need to work on myself a little bit more. Maybe I need to connect with a few more people or something to give myself a better chance.
Mm-hmm.
So you see weaknesses and strengths.
There's
and those are great things to know.
There's something that you actually mentioned when you know, I you know, studied with you in regards to the type of information that you relay over to your, you know, your guest. It's something about never give bad news or, you know,
Yeah. I tell people there's no such thing as a bad reading, just bad readers.
Yeah.
And they seem
yeah.
to like that idea.
Yeah, yeah.
And I said, you know, you want to be truthful. And I'm a big fan of Aristotle. And Aristotle, many centuries ago, said ultimately we all want to be happy. That's the goal. And we're all mm-hmm. chasing happiness in one way or another. And I think he was right. I think to live happily ever after, you have to make good choices.
Yeah.
And you can't make good decisions if you're afraid of the truth. You know, mm-hmm. if something's good, it's good. If it's not, it's not. You know, and you've got to be realistic and you've got to be truthful. But at the same time, I always said a reading should do one of two things. It should give you good news or it should give you some good advice. But
exactly.
either way, I think it should be constructive and it should be helpful.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe you can be constructive and helpful and still be truthful. I think those things can be combined. And when you're doing that, I think you're doing good things to people with the
yeah.
reading and helping them.
Yeah, helping them understand the energies.
Right. But
yeah.
I think Krista would agree that the last thing you can do as a reader is get your ego involved. When it mm-hmm. becomes that you're more important than the person you're reading for, when it's all about proving what a great psychic you are or something, people hurt a lot of people. And
yeah.
it's not the way to approach it. From a
yeah.
point of ego, you know, it's to be humble
yeah,
in doing
service.
A reading and want to be of service and want to help mm-hmm. others. And I think Krista
it's
would
true.
Agree.
And one of the things I've learned from going to readings, but also being a reader, is the archetype of the oracle is incredibly powerful. So when you sit down, you are embodying that archetype for the moment, and then you go home and watch hockey and you know, hopefully have a normal life like we try to do. So in a way, I also approach it from that point of view that I feel I have to be really aware of my effect on people with words. And so one of the art of being a good oracle is saying the right words. Mm-hmm. And that is somewhat of an intuitive process for me. They bubble up in my mind and I'll sort of hear a particular phrase about how I want to describe this reading. Mm-hmm. And I pick them very carefully for some reason. And it has proven to be helpful to people. They even say, well, I was just talking to my friend today, those exact words. And I think, well, how is that even possible? Because I think Michael and I, we don't emphasize the psychic stuff because we don't think it's the real reason people need readings. And so when you get that, you're like, wow, I don't know where I got that. You know, I got that because of the cards and my own sort of respect to the process. I've always been very respectful to readers myself. Mm-hmm. And I really take my readings fairly seriously. I take them to heart. And I've discovered that I really took a lot of the advice I was given from good readers, and it really made a big difference in my life, including going to Nova Scotia. Yeah. And I said, so I know it works because I used it. Mm-hmm. But I think it's part of out of that respect, I think it's important that you know you're going to have that impact on someone when they come in, and to realize it, you know, it's a very powerful archetype that you're embodying temporarily.
Right.
And so I think it's not only important what Michael's saying to give the best, you know, advice in a sense to be truthful, but how you say it and your sensitivity. And again, no one has to be perfect. I think we all make some mistakes, but just being aware, I guess, is and I think some readers they're not aware of the effect their language has on people.
Yeah, just being really present and conscious on, you know, the vehicle of communicating.
Right,
you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, most definitely. Now, I have a playful question for you guys. You spent many years studying each card. All right, so for each of you, which card is your favorite? I mean,
that's a tough question. It's like asking which of your children do you like the best.
Right.
You know, honestly, I don't know if I necessarily have a favorite. Because I think they all work as a whole.
Yeah.
And if
you
take away one piece, it all falls apart. And they each have. I would say that if I have to answer, if you put a gun to my head and said, pick a card.
Well, there's no guns.
Anything that would fall on the center pillar, I think, is the best. Because for me, it's about doing what's necessary. It's about doing God's work. It's about serving the greater good, not my ego, not my... And I don't want to see my desires and fears. I don't like that subjective energy as much. I want to know I'm in accordance with the greater good.
Balance.
And anything that has that balance to it, I think, is probably going to be my favorite. But really, what I love is the tarot.
Yeah.
And each and every card and each and every part of it. And
yeah, there is a romance with each, you know,
I find that I
have kind of a romantic involvement with just the cards that get, you know, presented in any reading.
Well, Crowley says it in his book that I love this. He says that each of the cards is actually a window to a reality. Mm-hmm. And I think that's absolutely true in terms of physics. And I've had a couple of experiences with that. One year I was playing around with the Empress and I thought, well, I'm going to meditate on the Empress. That's one of the things people do. They take the major arcana. There's a whole system of schools that are around meditating and growing and building yourself inwardly. And all I would do really was gaze at that card a lot. And then I started having... In Crowley's deck, there's a pelican in the deck of the Empress. I started having these encounters with pelicans.
Oh, synchronicity.
They would come really close to me. Yeah. I found dozens of pelican feathers. I've never found that much before. Mm-hmm. It was as if I was now opening myself up to the world of the Empress.
Wow.
And I thought, oh my God, this is amazingly true. Mm-hmm. And I guess I better be careful which world I want to visit right now.
Right.
It was very magical. And I've had several things where I've had the major arcana kind of appear. The Fool, I've had encounters with people that are really almost look like the Fool when I'm working with that card. And and I think that I really think physics would sort of back that up, that there are different realities out there and you just have to be able to remove your filters
and be
open to it and it's going to present itself, you know?
Yeah. I think one of the hardest cards that I have ever encountered in a reading that I've had was surrendering to the Hangman, you know, whenever that would appear, you know, that's sort of a, you know, it's such a pivotal, it's such a metaphor for life, you know, in order to, you know, let go.
Just let go.
Let go.
Let go and And sometimes you just can't do anything. You have to just trust. You know, and it's all, the left pillar is all about really trust.
And it's so interesting how the hangman is like, no, I don't want to give up. No, but you're
I'll tell you a funny story about the hangman. Maybe you'll see it different. Yeah. And, and in Christian interpretation of the tarot, the hangman is actually the crucifixion of Christ. And I was having dinner with a friend of mine who's a minister one night, and he's a really cool guy, and we were hanging out. And I said to him, Jim, I said, do you actually understand the real message of the crucifixion? He said, well, Christ died for our sins. I said, well, I don't think that's it. Now, I said, I'm an ignorant heathen, unlike you. I can't really quote the scripture. But I said, all I've got is just simple logic. So we'll work with that.
Right, right.
So I said, Christ was the Son of God, right? And he said, yeah. And I said, so God was his dad, right? And he said, yeah. I said, so that's better than having Bill Gates as your dad or Warren Buffett. I mean, God is the most powerful, omnipotent force in the whole universe, and he's your father.
Right, right.
And yet here the Son of God still finds himself nailed to a cross. So I said, isn't the real lesson of even the Son of God can have a bad day? What makes you think you're so friggin' special?
Oh, no.
Something won't happen to you in life, you know? And that's just the way it is.
Right,
and
right.
The salvation is that we're not being punished for our sins. It's just because life is difficult sometimes, and sometimes we have to go along with that and accept it and move through it. And that's just part of the everyone goes through those experiences.
Yeah.
So we're not being persecuted.
It's also perspective, too. I mean, it takes a little bit of time to actually realize that those very profound moments, those moments that hurt, you know, or are just, you know, it's scrambled in a mess, actually lead, you know, I mean, it's a little debatable, but some I have found in my personal experience, it leads you into exactly more of you, more your authentic self.
Sure.
And let's be honest, without the crucifixion, Christ would have been nothing. You know, it's how we face our adversities in life and so forth that make us great people. And the wisdom of the tower is that these things can't be avoided, and you shouldn't try and avoid them. You should embrace them.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can embrace it, then the suffering disappears, so to speak. I acknowledge that I can't control this. I'm going to surrender and accept and not fight it.
And it's a process,
It's fighting that unwinnable fight that creates the suffering, so to speak. And we have to know when we can do something about something and when we just can't, you know.
We have
to accept graciously.
I have a funny story about the hangman. This is totally opposite of Michael's, but it's based on I was at a party, and you know, the hangman in the Crawley deck is naked, completely naked. And there's a woman there, and she got the reading, and I don't know where the hangman was, but he was there, and it was actually probably upright to her, but the only card she saw, she looked at the hangman and goes, I love that naked man.
Oh, wow. Who is this?
And it turns out, you know, based on the Kabbalah, you know, we see that as part of the healer's path. Turns out she was a masseuse.
Mm-hmm.
And I was really amazed that she resonated positively, because I've honestly never had anyone look at that card and immediately love it and celebrate it. And she just somehow knew what it meant for her. And she wasn't really having a lot of struggles in her life. And I thought, well, it's all about context with the hangman, you know.
Yeah.
And so in her case, because that's who she is, she felt a rapport to it, too. So again, you know, it depends on the context what the hangman would mean, you know. And that's why Kabbalah is good, and that's why, you know, you have to look at the pattern of the layout, and also maybe if there is a question or something. But I'll never forget that, because it floored me at the time. It was just so funny.
Now, you guys, I mean, obviously you offer classes, you know, periodically throughout the year. And
Once in a while.
Now, are you thinking about, you know, re-embracing that this year in general?
We've talked about it, and I think, you know, it's probably something that we'll do. We haven't come up with a definitive date that we're going to do it yet,
kinda,
but I suspect we'll do at least one class this year, and maybe two, but we kind of go with the flow, and we get enough people that have expressed an interest. Now, one of the things I've noticed that we do, and it's based on our first experience in teaching, is that we try and make ourselves unavailable. To a great degree, and because we hate wasting our time, we're busy people. And we the first time we did a class, people were bugging us. We wanted to do this class, and we said fine. So we put it together. And the first week, everybody showed up. The second week, hardly anyone showed up, and they kind of all drifted off. Nobody really wanted to be there.
Wow.
So the second class, we had people that were bugging us. We wanted to do a class, and we kept not returning their phone calls and dodging them and putting them off.
The velvet rope.
Studio
54.
And they kept bugging us. You know, please let's do this. Please, please, please. Yeah. And after we'd made them jump through enough hoops and they hadn't quit, we realized they probably want to be there. And that class was amazing. Everybody stuck through it. We had a wonderful time. They were great students. So I think sometimes we linger in putting together a class just to see who really wants to be there and who really is just sort of a passing fancy, but they're not really dedicated to doing it. Because I think it's really only fun for us to work with students that are really dedicated and wanting to learn it, you know?
Well, so as we're, you know, we're approaching the end of the show and, you know, honestly, nobody has called, but that's okay. You know, I'm not going to take it personally. We're still going to, you know, give you incredible knowledge about Kabbalah Tarot. I was hoping that we can do like a quick spread. I mean, there's a multiplicity of spreads to select sure. from, mm-hmm. but if I could be a guinea pig and, sure. and you know, be a caller, let's see here. What type of reading is available?
Well, I mean, we can do just about anything that you really want to do. Now, mm-hmm. the tricky part with reading sometimes is it may relate to you, but somebody who doesn't have the background and knowledge of what you're talking about may have a hard time following it or understanding what we're talking about. Yeah. So it might be better if you have a very specific subject that at least we can relate to.
Sure. Let me see here. You know, general, just immediate snapshot of what energies that are coming, you know, within a certain time frame that the cards communicate.
Like yeah. So we're just going to look at your overall energies and see what you're going to be dealing with.
Hey.
Well, actually, some very good stuff. The first thing, when we look at a spread of tarot cards, there are two cards I like to analyze first. One talks about your state of rational mind. One talks about your subconscious, your instinct, your intuition, the irrational part of self. We simply call them head and heart. The reason those are two important cards to me in the spread is that it tells me about your clarity. I want to know if you're looking at things objectively and realistically, or if you're crazy, as I tell people. And people like it when I tell them they're not crazy, and I don't think you're crazy, Christine.
Tonight. Oh, thank you. thank you.
But that I mean that you're willing to look at things truthfully and realistically. Your expectations are realistic and at a healthy level and so forth. Sure. And the crazy states are just commonly referred to as fantasy and denial. And in those states, people see what they think they see, but they're not really open to the truth.
Exactly.
And according to this, with the Nine of Wands in your rational mind, the Ace of Cups in your soul, I think you're looking at life pretty objectively at the moment. So I think that you're being realistic about things. I think that the desires that you have in life are achievable. Mm-hmm. And with those alone, it tells me you should be able to trust your judgment right now, do what you feel is best. And if you're not second-guessing yourself, but if you're acting decisively, I think that good things will happen. I think you move your life in a very healthy direction. The other thing I would notice is that you're coming into a time where there's a lot of recognition and strength in front of you, and that's a good sign too. Mm-hmm. Now, the thing with recognition, the Seven of Wands in front of you, the Seven of Swords, a lot of seven energy. Seven's that right-hand pillar. It tends to be very extrovert. Mm-hmm. And so coming into that cycle, you're going to get a lot of attention and recognition. Now, to somebody in radio, that would be a good thing. We want to get your name out there. We want people to find out you exist and so forth. And your DJing would be a good thing.
Stereo.
But please keep in mind, too, when you're exposed and visible, you don't get away with much either. So if you're no good, then you're going to get caught, too.
Exactly.
So it's important to really do everything you do with openness and honesty and dignity and so forth.
Like
I think as long as you can
maintain
your dignity, and that means you can't violate any of your real core values or beliefs. You have to be true to yourself under those energies, and you really have to act with pride. So that would be kind of the thing that would get you in trouble. And then I think that you're just in a cycle that's really good for growth. I think especially, and the interesting thing with Kabbalah is that it allows you to really nail down timing to a significant degree. And for me, when I look at this reading, especially as we move into the fall, I think that even the summer, July, August, September, October, those 4 months in particular, I think are going to have a lot of strength in the energies that are in front of you and a lot of opportunities. So for me, you should have a pretty big summer this year with the energies that are directly in front of you.
I'm looking forward to it.
So
by the beach.
I'd be really open to it. I think it's a lot of growth energy, which I think is good. Mm-hmm. I think that the biggest mistake you could make is to let other people sway your judgment. If you go away from your truth, if you let other people persuade you about things, talk you out of things you believe in, you know, pressure you into things you don't believe in.
Yeah.
I think that you're really committing a lot of errors with a spread like I see in front of me. And I think
agree.
That that's where you'd be in a lot of trouble if you allow that. And I'll let Krista have some insight too. She probably sees things I don't.
No, I agree with everything you're saying. I also think that it's a good period for like maybe particular allies. Like there's a lot of cards about you just doing your own thing and going for it, but that you could form some significant or almost like solidify some significant allies in your life. It has good partnership energy as you go through the summer and into the fall. And you certainly can be, you know, somewhat selective based on, again, what Michael's saying. Your thinking is very good. Mm-hmm. Your mind might be a little tired, but it's accurate, you know, very. And then you have new energy kind of coming in. You have a kind of a lusty self, though, so beware.
What? Wow. No, that's not me. No.
I'm just teasing you, but it is a very good, I think it's a very important cycle, too. I think it's honestly setting up your destiny.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't mean that in a kind of new agey way, but, you know, in sort of ways that would make sense to you. You could see it yourself becoming even more grounded and clear about your direction, and not just with yourself, but with some other people too. Mm-hmm. I really like it.
Yeah. The other thing I would say about this, sorry to jump in, but
please.
Before the thought disappears. The other thing I think in this particular pattern is that it's not a pattern that benefits from procrastination. Mm-hmm. If you delay things unnecessarily, you put things off till later, it doesn't favor you in terms of having better opportunities to achieve the things in life that you desire. So your strong cycle is actually currently and what's directly in front of you.
Make it happen
now.
It's
time to make things happen. And, mm-hmm. and I just think that there's a mistake in this reading again. If you were, and sometimes you'll tell people, look, just wait a little bit, be patient, and there'll be better opportunities, doors will open. But for you, now's your time. You know, mm-hmm. there are energies that are lining up directly in front of you that can really allow you to live happily ever after and achieve a lot of good things. So so don't feel like it's a good idea to put things off.
And it really does feel like it's happening now, too, you know, sensationally. Mm-hmm.
For sure.
Yeah, well, that was the first time that I had my tarot card reading broadcast.
Broadcast.
Okay. All right. So,
brave
you know,
soul.
You know, for the ones at work, now you know what's going to need to be happening for me for the, you know, upcoming energies here. Now, Krista, you also complement, readings with more of a shamanic touch, totems.
Mm-hmm.
Would you mind sharing some of that, you know, information as far as how that works and what pops up?
Sure. Jamie Sams has a beautiful deck that she did with David Carson. It's my favorite deck, and it has birds and animals. And the concept of the totem is that it's a spirit teacher and oftentimes part of yourself. And I really do see it as something where I can learn from the totem. Mm-hmm. And usually I include one card in a reading, even if people aren't familiar with it, as just kind of an overall totem temporarily for people.
Right.
And what's nice is it really can interact in people's life. And everybody loves it. So the real animal will often already have come into people's lives. Like they'll pick the skunk. And I remember this one woman, she was living in Beverly Hills and she rescued skunks. I kid you not.
Wow.
And I have that happen a lot where the animals already appeared, or they have a really funny story about a rabbit dropped on their porch by an owl the other night and they'd pick the rabbit.
Right.
In fact, rabbit has some really funny things that happen for some reason when people pick it. But the idea is that you can use that totem right away to help integrate your life ever in any direction, emotionally, spiritually, practically. People have pulled it for where do I live, and they'll pick an animal that will guide them to their residence.
Yeah.
And people can see it so easily because it's an animal or bird and they can relate to it and use it right away.
It's an additional layer of understanding, you know, the energies you're working with.
I think it's also connects people to their souls, because I feel that the medicine cards are part of our soul, and our soul knows that language, and it feels very comfortable to connect to nature, and it just reminds people. And I think even if you're deeply connected to nature, the totems take you to the next level of whatever that is, because I think it's kind of infinite how close we can be with nature and what kind of communion. It offers a communion to nature that's not esoteric. It's very real.
Mm-hmm.
People have real stories with real animals and have had help because of them. So that's why I really like it. And people, they're like
I always
kids
love
when
that,
they pick it.
Love
you know?
That additional layer of compliment to the readings. I mean, you know, I you know, even though I've been taught by both of you, I still return to you for that deeper level of insight. I mean, I could sit at home and, you know, read it for myself, but I don't know, there's something about your communication skills and your depth of knowledge that, you know, it's just a bit insatiable. I'm like, okay, you know what I mean? You know, I need my Michael and Krista fix, you know. I mean, so if you wouldn't mind, may I draw one of those cards?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Let me just shuffle it a little bit, and this, you can use it as long as you like. And
just to give people a little bit of taste of,
you can just pick one that maybe that's easier that way.
What the reading would be like.
Yeah, I usually, like I said, I do it as, it usually either sums up the reading for me or it gives me something I missed. Oh my goodness. Okay, we know a lot about crows.
And why is that?
Let's just say we have good friends that are crows.
Yes.
Well, and Jamie Sam says the crow is about sacred truth and walking your talk and living your truth, which is true because the crow is not afraid to speak up. And in fact, usually when you pick the crow, it's time to speak up.
You know,
and
truth,
exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And they're also very proud. And so Michael likes to say with the crow, you can kind of strut your accomplishments a little bit. You know, it's okay to kind of brag with your friends
a
bit.
Leo Madheaven. I have a Leo Madheaven.
They're obviously very smart and they're very creative. And they're also interesting when you pick the crow. I feel like you're in line to meet your mate because crows mate for life. And I usually see the 24 as a 2-year cycle for, you know, finding your mate and family. And it's a really great one for you to pick because obviously the crow is very common. So you're going to have a lot of crows coming up and talking to you now.
You know, and it's interesting. You know, it's so interesting that the crow has returned into my life. I have a quick story that I want to share. I went out to Joshua Tree, you know, with... and I was camping out there and the whole thing, right? And so when I was driving back, I mean, I had the most cosmic, amazing experience. I remember being in a, what do you call it? A hot springs experience and looking up and seeing a hawk circling, you know, and just speaking. And I'm like, whoa, it was sort of like nature was saying, now pay attention, right? And then as I was driving back to LA, right? And it's a beautiful stretch. It really is. A murder of crows as you know, a large pack. Is called, it's actually called a murder, which is so fascinating to me. I'm like, whoa. Literally, you know, there's a spiritual awareness that kicks in. Once you tune into nature, there is this exchange that happens. There is a conversation that happens. Yes. And so as they were flying along with me, right, I knew that they were now part of my journey. They were now going to be making their presence known. So I get back to my apartment, right? And no joke, I'm on the phone with one of my best friends. And, you know, I told her the crow is, you know, my spirit guide. You know, I told her that. And she's like, and, you know, we're having, you know, we're a great conversation. I think we were drinking wine and, you know, you know, telling stories, whatever. And literally on my white picket fence, two crows were looking into the window and going, and then my friend was like, you know, wow, you know, are those crows, Christina? I'm like, yeah, they're my spirit guide. They're trying to tell me something right now, but I'm on the phone with you. Yeah, okay. You know, so I was a little torn. But true story, that's what it's like to be
magical. We had a bunch of crows that hang out in front of our house, and I was out washing my car one day, and I looked up, and there was one little crow sitting on the wire watching me very intently, and I swear to God, I could hear a voice inside my head, the crow talking to me, and I went into Krista. I said, there's this crow out front. And he said that they'll keep an eye on our car so long as we feed them. Now, I said, being crows, I'm pretty sure it's a scam, but we probably should feed them anyway. So ever since then, we've been feeding the crows. And, and if we ever have a day where we don't feed them, they come and they crap all over the car.
You know what I mean? Wow, wow.
So we kind of call them the Sopranos.
That's so funny. That's funny. Yeah.
Little extortion there. So crows are a unique species for sure. But they're wonderful birds. And again, misunderstood. You know, birds that were black or dark were often associated with evil and all that spooky stuff.
Yeah, I wear black too. Kundalini yoga. Everyone wears white, and I'm like, but I'm spiritual, man.
You know,
But they're very intelligent.
No,
they're
just
very
a dash of black. So that's wonderful. I'm so glad you were able to go ahead and share that. And you know, I'm the guinea pig for tonight, and you know, fully broadcasted. So I do appreciate it, and I'm very grateful for your talent, your level of dedication, your honoring of the practice. You know, your honoring of you know, basically just being completely truthful, honest, and helping people. Being of service in this world is one of the most magical things that we could ever do in this
definitely
wild
is.
Ride.
For me, that's
it
what
is
it's
a wild
all
ride.
About.
Yeah, right.
Sure.
Yeah. Absolutely. So, where can people find you? For those who were literally sitting on the phone and just going, "I want to call, but am I going to be the only caller?" You know, whatever. Where can they have a private moment with you?
Well, we work from our home in Venice, and then we also work at the bookstore, Mystic Journey Bookstore in Abbot Kinney, and I think it's 1624 Abbot Kinney Boulevard. We're there, and that you can actually go onto their website and book us online or call them.
Right.
And you can also find us at www.mysticraven.net. And book a private reading too. So either
and
would be
we do
fine.
Readings over the phone and Skype and stuff like that.
Beautiful.
We have clients. We've been doing this almost 20 years now, so we have clients all over the world that call us. We're blessed. We've met some really amazing people over the last 20 years, for sure.
That's
some amazing experiences.
Yeah, I have to admit that's
meeting
pretty special.
You is a blessing too, though.
Well, thank you. Yeah. We're really honored to be on your show. I think it's really a great show, great idea. Yeah. You're awesome, and
you're awesome too.
You have a great radio voice. You're going to do very well. And
hello. Welcome to the Masters.
It's been a lot of fun.
Yes. So if sending our audience off with one last message, what would it be? No pressure.
Ooh, what would it be? You know, embrace the truth. As simple as that. I think if people embrace the truth, I think that ultimately you move your life in a positive direction no matter what. I think when we hide from the truth, that's when we're in trouble. So no matter what, whether you like it or not, embrace the truth.
Oh, that's gorgeous. Krista, do you have anything for our audience?
I just say, you know, just connect with nature and observe nature around you that's there all the time, and you'll start getting your own messages, and you'll never feel lonely again, to tell you the truth, if you remember that there's always a being of some kind that will connect with you, and that it doesn't have to be just people. It can be really even trees I felt connected to and plants. If you really, really pay attention to them and really acknowledge them, it's not something so difficult.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I would say is spend more time in nature and really connect and trust your own messages that come to you through nature.
Oh, that's beautiful. I love you both so, so much. You guys are amazing. I'm so honored to call you my teachers, my friends, and truly, you know, a gift in this world. So thank you for coming to the Master's Playground. I'm going to close out with my traditional, you know, Kundalini stuff. So, all right. May the long time sun shine upon you. All love surround you, and the pure light within you guide your way on. Sat Nam. Blessings.
Love yourself. Love each other,
each other, each other,
each other, each other,
each other, each other,
each other.
We are one,
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 we are one.
We are
the divine,
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 the divine.
Blessings,
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 blessings.
The Master's
Playground.